upstairs and everybody both come, but we just start anyway. Thank you all for coming, first thing. This session is going to be about, you know, and the modules, but I'm going to focus specifically in site building and maintenance of a Drupal site. My name is Fran. A little bit more about me. I work for Amazy Labs. You've got in there my contact details. I'm basically on Drupal or any other place outside my company. You can find me as FJ Gardening. As I said, I work in mainly maintenance and support, so we do work with a myriad of sites, which are Drupal 6, 7, and 8. We do a little bit of, not a little bit, we're starting to do more and more React as well. Integration, we work with GraphQL, but as I said, this talk is going to be mainly, I don't know what I'm doing with this, about site maintenance and support. So the first 5 minutes, we talk a little bit about a few things that I'm going to be talking later on, so that we know the context. Then I'm going to be basically throwing at you a whole bunch of modules, which hopefully will be helpful for you. And then we end up talking a little bit about that, and having a discussion. I'm more than open to any questions at the end. Okay. I've tried to structure this in blocks, so we'll start with hyper blocks, site building, and then a bit more use specific cases. In case you are wondering about my accent, I live in Birmingham for the last 7 years. So we'll just leave it at that. No. If you don't understand me or anything, just please ask me to repeat. Okay, I know that I have a bit of a strong accent. As usual, probably it might be tiny, but that way it will make you listen to me, which is good. All the slides are available in slides.com, so you can just follow them along now or listen to me as well. So at the beginning is to code or not to code, and basically I divided site building versus backend versus frontend. I know that is an oversimplification, but basically, when I talk about backend, I talk about mostly coding. When I talk about frontend, I talk about mostly coding as well, because we're coding CSS, we're coding JavaScript, we're coding theming integration. So at the end of the day, it's coding. And then we have site building, which again is a huge oversimplification, but it's mostly clicking around. Okay. So you start Drupal, you go next, type a few things, but it's mostly done through the UI. So I really think that this is very powerful. I mean, I do like the three aspects. I do a bit of everything. Whatever you throw at me, we try my best to solve it. But I think that the site building sometimes is... people don't appreciate how powerful it can be. One of the great things of that is the community, the variety of modules that we have. Probably you've all heard the phrase already, there is a module for that in Drupal. So that's true, look for that. And probably somebody has done the hard work for you. And we'll focus mostly on that today, site building. And there are a couple of slides and a couple of modules that are like more back-end, front-end oriented. But most of the modules we're going to be talking about, they are related to site building. So my question is, what do we need when we are building a site? Okay, if it's a new site, we need time savers, because usually we want to spend most of the time building what the client is paying us to build. So installing Drupal, having a nice responsive menu, those are things that are really built in. We don't want to charge the client for that. It wouldn't make any sense, because then we wouldn't have time to focus on the most important features. So a whole bunch of these modules are going to be time savers for you. When we're building a new site, we need modules. And then I'm making a note here on environments. I will come back to that in a little bit. And then the other question is, if you remember, it was building or maintaining your site. So what do we need when we are maintaining our site? So when we are maintaining, that usually means bug fixing, it means security updates, it means extensions. It means that it's an existing site. Usually when it's a new site, you just don't worry. You just work on prod branch, and you just start doing things because the site is not live. But when we're talking over of an existing site, we really need to worry about the plumbing. How am I going to transfer all this that I'm doing, this full week of work, how am I going to transfer all that to the prod server? Okay, and then again, I'm making a note here on environments. And basically, this is the note that I wanted to talk about. So environments, that usually tend to depend on the size of the project, on the size of the company, and also on the level of skills and knowledge of the team. I've worked on pretty much all the four cases that I've set in here. They are all real cases, and probably some of you at some point have working over them. So one of them is working on production. Who has SSH into the production server and made a live change? more than once, more than twice. So that's a reality. It's not ideal, but it's a reality. It's there. But I'm going to discard that for now, okay? Because it's not maintainable in that sense. But we need to worry about version control, whether we change files and all that, and it could create an output. Probably one of the most common ones, especially on small projects, small companies, not a very skilled team, is development and production. So I have a development copy, and then I have the prod version of it. But then if we want to go a bit deeper into that, we can work with local version, that local get pushed to a development version, which tends to be accessible by clients and all these sort of things, so that they can test the features before we release to production. Or there are your projects, again, remember the context, it really depends on the project, it really depends on the size of the company, how many people are working at the same time, what's the volume of work that we are doing for that project. So we can have the situation in which we have as well local development, staging, and production. Who is working or who has been working in the last scenario? So a lot of us, and I think that there's a reason for that. It's by far the safest, especially on big projects. It allows you to play as much as you want locally. You can just do your own thing in your computer. You know that you are not messing around with anybody else's work. You can delete records, you can add new records, that's not a problem. Then once you are kind of happy with the things, you move into development. Development, you usually expose the work to other developers, to the project manager, product owner, things like that. And once everybody is happy, then move to staging. And if it works in staging, that means that it's very likely to work on production, as it's pretty much the same copy. So this was kind of the note that I wanted to do on the environment. I don't think that they are super, super, super important at the very beginning. I think that they are very, very, very important on existing sites for obvious reasons. Let's just move on and basically start talking about those modules that I was talking about. And at the beginning, we're going to start creating, setting up a project. So what do we need when I'm setting up projects? And this module is really handy because I don't know how many of you have been doing a change on a view or something and then realized that you were working off the production URL. So that has happened to me, that has happened to many other people. And this module, in that sense, is pretty cool because it allows you, it's available for both Drupal 7 and 8. Most of the modules that I'm presenting today, they're available for both. And this is a very simple module, but basically you can just configure colors per environment. So I usually use green for local, blue for development, and red for production, because if you are working on something that has a red top bar, then you are conscious that you are going on, you are doing something on somewhere with a red button. Okay, red buttons, red things are for something. Okay, so it tends to be really useful. It's really simple to configure. It takes really 3 lines of code. You can do everything through the UI. Okay, you can just install the module, tell Drupal which are the development URLs, and basically if the URL matches that, it will just apply that code. If not, you can always put it in settings.php. If we're talking Drupal 8, we have we can export configuration. So it's really easy to set up. So next module, remember we're setting up our site. Now I know that I'm not going to mess up in production. I know if I am in development or local. Something cool about this module is that it offers you links, so in whichever page you are in, you have a link to go to the exact same page to development or to production, which tends to be handy as well. Backup and migrate. Remember, all this is site building. We're clicking around, okay? We're not coding, we're not doing SQL dumps and all that. So backup and migrate is a module that allows us to backup the database and move it across instances. But it's not only for database, it also helps with code and with files. Obviously the size of the export increases, but you can also do that. And one of the cool features is that you can send it to different destinations, like another folder on the server, and you can move one database to another one, and you can upload to an FTP server, Amazon S3, even by email. So it's again, it's pretty useful, especially for site builders to move databases around. Okay, remember, we're still setting up our site. I don't really want to move files. 300 megs of files is okay. 10 gigs of files is not okay to put in your local machine. Okay, so if we copy the whole files folder, which we can do with this one, we would be transferring over 10 gigs of files, which is just nonsense, pointless. Sometimes we just opt for not doing it, and we usually have this kind of site without images. We can still work on it. We know what we're doing, we're just changing a view, so we don't actually need the image. But then there is this very handy module, which is a stage file proxy, in which you just tell us, Drupal. In this case, it's got to be, I believe, via, I think it's got UI. I usually do it through drugs or through a conf variable in settings, but I think it might be UI as well. You can set up the URL. And basically, you just tell, this is the prod URL. And every time that it queries an image, if it doesn't find it on the local, it will download it automatically. So that means that next time, it will be already on your machine. So you're still effectively downloading images, but you are not bringing the whole pack. You are just bringing the ones that you need, the ones of the pages that you are working on. It's kind of useful because sometimes, I mean, in this case, this example is rendering fine without images, the top image, but there are some times in which when we don't have the image, the CSS breaks completely and things start floating around and all these sort of things. So sometimes it's really handy as well to have the images, and as I said, this is just a one-liner on the settings.php. It can just bring the images and have a pretty accurate copy of what the prod looked like. Another one, remember, we're still setting up our site. So you all know that GDPR is coming. Basically, that's all about privacy. Which are the main consequences? I mean, there's a lot going on with GDPR, like right to be forgotten, exporting data, and all these sort of things. But as developers, what we care about is that sometimes I really need to work with a copy of the prod data, because it's a problem that I cannot debug locally, because the data is different. And locally I have 10 users, and on prod I have 10,000. So sometimes you really need the data. When GDPR comes into practice, it would be a breach of law to bring in that data to your local machine and then walk outside of the building with your machine. We all use laptops, so if you take your laptop to your home and for whatever reason somebody hacks into your computer, you are giving away data. So what this module does, and by the time I wrote this presentation, there was not a lot going on with this one. I will come back to this in a little bit. But basically what this module does, it just gives you a UI in which you just put the field name and which Faker function you want to use. Does anybody know about this Faker library? This Faker library is a PHP library. Okay, as you know, Drupal is written in PHP. So that's a PHP library that gives you, instead of giving you lorem ipsum, it gives you realistic fake data. Okay, so you can ask to Faker, give me a person, and it will give you a fake name, a fake address, but it will look real. Okay, they will give you age, date of birth, email address, credit card information, telephone, all this sort of thing. So it's got a very, very cool interface. It's got a lot of possibilities. Definitely, I think it's nicer than working with lorem ipsum users. I mean, we all use the base generate at some point to generate users. Many times, username is just 50 characters. Doesn't make any sense. With Faker, you can get realistic info. And you still have, this module, it is a bit, it is still in alpha, so just work with caution. But basically, you just need to know a little bit of JSON and how to put a JSON array together, in which, as I said, you put the field name and the Faker function. Field name, Faker function. And then you just click a button, and that will fake all the data of all your users in the database. You've got the possibility to fake individual data, but you usually want to do it on the whole database. It uses batch API, so if you have a question?
Yeah. Will those users still keep the Drupal roles once you fake names and last names and stuff?
Yes. Basically, you can, whatever you don't define in that array, it won't be changed.
Okay.
Okay? And it uses, if somebody wants to look into the code, it uses entity API, so it's just basically a generic setter and getter for values. It would just try to put the values that you put in that array. If it cannot do it, it will just not do it, as easy as that. But if you don't specify anything for email, the email will be the same. If you don't specify anything for surname, the surname will be the same. So it really depends to how you configure that. Cool things is that it has a drust command, so you can automate that into deployments. And maybe when you are copying over a prod database to your local machine, you can just do the drust command to sync the database and then run that after that. Or you can do it through the UI, and you can also configure it on settings.php, so it's pretty useful. I said at the beginning that I was going to talk about this module, and basically, about this module, I know all that because I did it. Okay, I wanted to put it because I think it's useful. At the beginning, when I tried to give it that name, and that name was already taken, but there was almost no development whatsoever, except last week, and it's been a huge development. One part of that module is sanitizing data. It only does it at username, email. I might mess up. Sorry. It only does it at username, email, and little else. So my plans on this are going to be, I'm planning to contact these guys so that either I help them or they help me. So that's why I wanted to put the two modules. Just keep an eye on that. You can use it. I've been testing with thousands and thousands of users, different mappings. It's not perfect. It needs more testing, but it does the job. That will make our development copies to be GDPR compliant, which is key when we are developers. So next module. So probably we all know about this one, the Bell, and who knows?
I just wanted to, from the previous one, sorry.
Yeah.
I just wanted to ask, have you got any plans to mix it in with Devel Generate so that you can create users with more realistic users?
That's a very good question. I didn't think of that. It might be. You can always go there and submit like a feature request. I didn't think of that. That's cool. Nice one. All right. So I was asking the question: who has used Devel before? So most of us at some point were Drupal developers, so this is a very, very handy module. It gives us a lot of helper functions for Drupal developers that we can put in code, like dumping a whole object, and it will just output it in a very nice and easy to digest way, better than a bar dump or something like that. It has a lot of submodules, it has some cool UI features that can help. So one of them is we can run PHP code, so it will bootstrap the whole Drupal code, and then you can just put a test. I use that a lot when I'm testing the individual parts of my module. So I just put the code in there and see if it runs, and yeah, that way I know that it's good. Instead of maybe running a whole Drush command that tries to update 6,000 users, so I just do it there for one user, it works, we're good. It can generate dummy content, as we've already talked about. It has very cool debugging information for theming, when you are theming, so it gives you contextual information about which template is this block coming from, and it gives you information about the pre-process functions. So it's very useful to know your way. You can switch users, which is a very handy feature as well, when you want to test the site as another user. You can edit variables, it's got a lot of useful blocks, and then it's got Drush commands available. I think we all know about it, so I won't go any farther. Or maybe I do. Emails. And if you see the name of the module, it's Devel. It's not a typo. One of the cool things that the Devel module does, it gives you the Devel mail log. And why is this useful? To make sure that emails are not actually triggered when testing. If you see there is a little asterisk in there, and there is this little sentence in there. So those were my early days with Drupal. It was a Drupal 6 project. I just set it up. Wow, I set up a Drupal project just from Chrome. 1,000 emails went out. So we needed to investigate which emails were those, email it to the client, apologize, etc. So I learned in my very first days of Drupal that you need to really think about emails. So one of the cool functionalities that the Devel module offers is it gives you a kind of this Devel mail log, and you can just set it up as usual in settings, but you can set it through the UI. Basically, every email that is tried to be sent via the site, it will just not be sent, actually, okay? We just put it, and you cannot see all that, but we can just set up a folder in the server or in my local machine, and then you can see the text version of that email. Again, I apologize for the size, but as you know, I mean, probably I knew this, that each screen would be a different size, so yeah, the slides are available online, so you can just check. It's very useful because, yeah, webform uses triggers emails, rules triggers emails on Chrome, etc., etc. There are some other modules. I just wanted to put Devel and the Devel module in there just because we have already installed it in the previous slide, so we don't need to install any other module. But there are these others, like we have reroute email that will actually send the email, but we'll send it to an email that we configured. So we can set up our own email address and all the emails will go there. Then if you are going on a more complex setup, if you are working on a virtual machine or Docker or whatever, if you don't know what that is, just ignore what I'm just saying, okay? But you could install a service which is Mailhawk, and basically that will capture all the email traffic in there. I will talk a little bit about this tomorrow on a Docker presentation, in case you're interested. And then, yeah, more things. So you can always play with third-party settings. And then I put in there a very silly, stupid snippet, which is 3 lines of code. And it just makes the site not send an email at all. So you can always go down that option. It's just a custom editor hook. And it just says, send emails. No, thank you. That's about it. OK? OK. Then another module. And it's Devel, again, it's not a typo. So I've named it Web Profiler. Initially, it was a separate module for Drupal 8. And eventually, they just migrated into, they just put all the functionality inside Devel. And if you want to see the information, the old project is still in there. And yeah, basically, it gives you loads and loads and loads of contextual information. is it uses the Symfony component, and so I guess maybe some of you have already set it up on Drupal 8, and it's really useful because it gives you a lot of information about the Drupal installation, about query, about time, about number of queries, and yeah, you can see the actual queries, and also you can even see where that query was triggered. So again, it's a very useful module when we are developing, that it will give us a lot of contextual information about the page we are visiting. We good so far? I know I talk a bit fast, but are you digesting more or less everything? Remember, the slides will be there, so you can always come back and just go through them slowly. Features module. This module is available for both Drupal 7 and 8. I think it's way more important in Drupal 7. And I think this is one of the reasons why Drupal 8 configuration management system is in place. So this was the very first initiative in which, we all know with Drupal 7, Drupal 6, everything was all over the place, configuration, data. So it was really difficult, especially when we are deploying code. So imagine we've created a content type with a view, with a block. How do I deploy that to prod? Then you needed to go and replicate the steps most of the time because everything was just, in there you can just not copy the database over. Okay, so you needed to go and do it. You could export things separately, but it was a bit of a pain. So features was the first attempt to wrap up functionality and put it all together in a package. Now we can just move across instances and enable it, and then it will create the content type for you, it will create the view for you, and it will configure as many things as it can for you. It is not, obviously, it wouldn't work with all the configuration, but it was the first attempt to tidy up a little bit Drupal configuration versus Drupal content. So it's still a very useful module. It has a lot of JOS commands, it's got a UI, and it's got a lot of related modules as well. As I said, you can still use it on Drupal 8. Probably it's not as meaningful because we can just export the whole config and import it. But maybe if you want to, develop like a blog page in which you are creating a view account type, you can always grab that and then move it across sites. So it's useful to make reusable configurations, okay? Cool. Coming back to this. I have to say, as I told you at the beginning, I'm working in maintenance a lot, and we still work with a lot of Drupal 7 sites, and this to me is gold. I mean, being able to have something on version control on Git, like I can just do on the prod server, git pull, and then run a command, and I don't need to worry about replicating steps, is really good. So, yeah, if you're not using it for Drupal 7, I definitely recommend it, and it's pretty cool. More modules, okay. With mobile, if you remember at the beginning, I was setting up an existing site, and now we're moving towards helping. So the site is already set up. What can I do to move it across environments? These kind of things. This module, many clients hate it, and many developers love it. And basically, you can see everything on prod. You cannot change anything on prod, which forces you, so somebody can say, that's silly, I can make a change into a view. If we're talking Drupal 8, that view should be in code, so you should do the change locally, you should export configuration, and then you should deploy the code, and have everything running by code. Not only that, there are many times in which clients really want access to the Drupal instance. How many times have a client mess up a site? Raise hands. Last week, I was working on a project. Basically, that project, again, Drupal 7. Many of our clients, they want full admin access, just because they want it. That site runs a competition which runs from January until April each year. So those are the key months for them, okay? 1 month ago, not 2 weeks, 1 month ago, the site goes into maintenance mode. Why is the site in maintenance mode? Have you done something? I'm asking all the other developers in Slack. Nobody has done anything. Client, do you know anything about that? No, don't know. Okay, let's just put it back online. Let's not worry about it. And fair to mention that it was one of the key events of the year. 2 weeks after, in one of the other key events of the year, site goes into maintenance mode again. Why? What's going on? And basically, the story goes as we don't even have the. I think you all know this. Like when there are Drupal updates, we have that Drupal message. There are available updates. Click here to download them. So the client with admin rights decided to click on that. The client with admin rights decided to click all the checkboxes of all the modules that needed updating and click on download. And luckily for us, when they did that, there was a message, this will put the site into maintenance mode. Yeah, submit. Luckily for us, the downloads didn't update because the server, the Nginx setup just couldn't let go to that page. So we were lucky that there were no actual file overwrite, but the site went into maintenance mode. There were 3 hours of my life that I will never recover. I think I lost a few years of life on that because of the pressure, because I'm the main lead of that project, and yeah, I was supposed to know what was going on, and I didn't. And eventually it was that there was a user which had super admin rights, and they just did that. So coming back to this module will let them see everything. They can still add content through it, so they can add a new article, they can add a basic page, but they couldn't let them for, by any reason, to change configuration, which is pretty handy. You can also put some filters in it. So there's another module, so if you want to bypass it as user one or whatever, there are always ways to bypass these kind of things. But I think it's useful as well to have it in there. The name is very similar to this other module that I just decided to put in there. And basically this read-only mode module is when you put the site in maintenance mode. Usually it shows a very uninstalled page, if you didn't remember to style the page, or a styled page, but it's just that page. You cannot navigate through the site. With this module, you can still navigate through the site, but you cannot do almost anything else. So it's an alternative to put the site into maintenance mode. I thought I'd mention it. It's kind of handy. More modules. Remember, I told you at the beginning I was going to throw loads of modules at you. You just take the ones you need. And probably most of us use this already for Drupal 7 and Drupal 8. It's, drop-down menus on hover. It's pretty handy, otherwise you need to be clicking around all the time. There were some modules for Drupal 7 that they've been already included in Drupal Core 8 because they made sense, like the live filtering of modules and permissions. So you've got all the links in there. I won't go too much about that. I shouldn't be telling you about this module because if you install it, you will never, ever, ever in your life remember where to find any option from Drupal. So with this module, it's got the Mac shortcut of, I think it was called Alfred before, and now it's Spotlight. Basically, you just press a key combination, type wherever you want to go, like clear caches or performance, and it just takes you to that page. So I installed it for some time, and I realized that little by little I was forgetting where was everything in Drupal. So handling with care. But yeah, I think it's pretty useful. It's got a lot of very useful shortcuts. Dropcar, so remember at the beginning we were talking about updates as well. Who knows about Dropcar? Good. So Dropcar is an external service, okay? So it's a paid service, and basically what they do, nobody knows about Dropcar. Who knows about updating modules and core? Okay, we all do. We all know the pain that that is and all these sort of things. So this external service, basically you need to give it access to Git and SSH to the server. And basically it does the Drupal updates for you, module and core, so you can configure, customize the whole workflow. So you can say this type of update, just ignore them. If it's a security update, just try to patch the program straight away. And there are some people that say that a broken site is safer than an insecure site. Okay, it's probably some clients don't want to have their site down, but maybe some others prefer to have it down because of the security implications. And basically, the point of this module is that you can just customize it, you can hook it up to Git, I can create automatically pull requests for you. It can test your site on staging. If you got it, if you've got automatic deployments, so for example, you imagine that you've got an automatic deployment to the prod branch, so it can commit to that branch, and that will trigger a deployment on the site, and it will do a lot of stuff for you. So if you're in maintenance, obviously, it's got integration with Jira, with Slack, with email. So if you're in the world of maintenance, obviously it requires a bit of more skills, but it could be useful. As I said, it's paid, but it's not really expensive, okay? So it's kind of affordable. It depends, as you saw, on the size of the company and how many projects you have. If you've got 3-4 projects, fair enough, you can do the updates yourself. If you've got 100 projects, then this kind of money can get handy. And then this is kind of the last of the helper modules, okay? After that, we've got the different sections. Just checking the time, we're good. Okay, so this is not a module as such, it's the settings.php file, we all know it. Many of us don't commit it to version control, which if you come tomorrow to my session, I will tell you a bit more about it. But there are some people that do commit it. They don't commit the whole settings, but maybe they commit specific settings for development, specific settings for production, and we can always have the local version that we don't commit. And basically, I'm happy to show you as well after the session if you want to know a bit more about how I do it or how we do it in my company. So we usually have a generic settings and which reads for the server variables, and that file can easily be committed to version control. And then we have specific setting files for development, so you cannot see the code in there, it's tiny. But for example, this is overriding the Google Analytics code. We don't want to have our testing going to analytics, it's just pain. We usually don't want to have cache. Usually when you set up the site, you need to go to system, performance, disable cache, blah, blah. With these settings, we're just disabling in the file, so we just don't need to worry about anything. So whenever we set the site, this will override whatever is on the database. And we've got the same situation for Drupal 7 and 8. And on Drupal 8, there's a differentiation between settings and config. I've just put a link in there if you want to know a little bit more. But for the purposes of what we are going to use it, it's really the same. We're just overriding data. Okay, few more site building modules. We're good so far? Not following? Cool. So, rules. This module is very powerful in Drupal 7. And we've been over this morning in the keynote from Ryan, Drupal Commerce. They use a lot rules, and basically it's the closest thing to coding without writing on an editor, okay? Which is both good and bad, okay? Because, you are coding into a database, which, kind of messes up the whole separation of concerns and all that. But anyway, you can basically set up conditional actions based on events, okay? You don't always need to code. I mean, you can code if you want, but there's a lot of code in the stack for you. So imagine that I just want to redirect a user, so instead of going to their user page, so when I log in, it usually goes to user one, and whatever. So imagine that I just want to redirect them to a dashboard, so there is a rule for that. So there is an event, which is when user logs in, and then there is an action, which says redirect to path, and then I can just put dashboard, and we go there. What if you want to send an email every time that somebody edits a certain node? You can do that via rules. So there is a lot of use cases that you can just use. And probably the biggest use case is Drupal Commerce. It's heavily built based on rules. And it's a really good example of it. It's reacting on events, basically. And you can import and export the features, so you can just move them across the sites, and integrates with token, etc., etc. For Drupal 8, they're working hard, but they need help, okay? There's a lot of progress done, so they've done basically all the hardcore stuff. They need to do now all the nice looking stuff, which is basically the UI. So all the API functions and all that, everything is written, but they need help. So I just put the link in there. If there is anybody willing to help in anything, I mean, when you are helping on a module, you don't need to be a hardcore developer. You can maybe help with documentation,
brilliant.
Or maybe just trying the module and reporting issues, that helps. Okay, so if you feel like helping them, that's the link, go for it. I recommend it. It's a really powerful module and we bring a lot of goodies for Drupal 8 as well. I believe that today there was meant to be a session on bricks, but the guy who did, couldn't make it at the end, I don't know. Has anyone gone to that session?
I tried.
You tried, and it didn't happen, no? Yeah, so I didn't want to explain too much because I knew that there was that session, but basically, if you see, this is a bunch of modules, paragraphs, bricks, field group, field collection. All these modules are just meant to ease a little bit the pain of the field management with Drupal. Okay, I'm not gonna go again into too much details. I just found it funny that in paragraphs, it's like paragraphs is the new way of content creation. Bricks is the new way of building pages. Both of them are good. It doesn't mean that they're bad. I mean, they're really good. One of the cool things of Bricks is that it integrates with Drupal Core and with the layout API, which is coming as a new feature for the latest versions of Drupal 8. But Drupal Paragraphs is as well really good, and it allows you, it gives you a lot of flexibility when creating content. Talking about layout of the pages and all that. So yeah, again, I recommend using it. Webform. Has anybody not used Webform? Okay, so this slide is for you. So basically, with Webform, you can just create custom Drupal out of the box. It gives you a contact form. That's about it. In Drupal 8, there is a bit more functionality. You can still build some forms, but it's very limited. And with this project, you can build custom forms, and then you can just download data, you can just email after the form submissions. So it's really good, like, if you are trying to do any sort of complex forms and do you want a lot of built-in functionality, it's really good. It's got a very extensive API, and they've come a long way as well in Drupal 8, and they've added a lot of new goodies that they weren't available for Drupal 7. So I recommend having a look at it.
Can I start?
Yeah?
The earlier GDPR stuff that you talked about, does that, can that sanitize web form submissions as well?
At the moment, it only does it with users. It uses the entity API, so I think in Drupal 8, if there are entities, we could potentially reuse some of the logic, but so long it's only for users. Okay, yeah, the other day somebody asked me, what if we have a content type which is awful? It doesn't do it for that, for now. But it could be a good feature to have. Thing specific, how are we with time? Was it meant to be until what time?
45.
Okay, if we go 5 more minutes?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry about that. Well, not sorry, but it is. I mean, if anyone needs to leave, just feel free to leave their own. Remember we were talking about site building, helper modules. So the Bootstrap module is a really cool module, and most of us know or might know the Bootstrap framework. It is really powerful, it has a lot of options, so there is a Bootstrap version for Drupal. It's got CDN support, so that means that it supports the Boost Watch, so we can set up different things out of the box. It works pretty well, especially, I haven't tried for the 8th version, but for the Drupal 7 it works very well. It could be a really good base theme. I mean, this is more really talking about Bootstrap than Drupal. So if you like Bootstrap, you would like this. If you want to go a bit more, have more control over it, there is this Omega module. If you install it out of the box, the site will be ugly, but you will have loads of possibilities to bring on top of it, and you will have loads of goodies, like, we could SaaS implementation and all these sort of things. I mean, it's got more than 1 million downloads, and I think that speaks a lot out of it. So if you're more of a front-ender, this could be a really good base module for you. If you don't know too much about front-end and you just want to get something nice looking, go for that, okay? It really depends on the needs of the project. Other use cases, I'm going to go a bit quicker about this. So what if we have a multilingual site? So in here we can see loads of countries, loads of different languages. So we used to have two modules on Drupal 7 for translation, and Drupal 8 decided to adopt entity translation. So that's the way that you should probably go for. And then there is some other helper modules like translation management that gives translators a lot of cool tools that they can use. As I said at the beginning as well, happy to explain any more on any of this when we finish. I'll be around. What if we have multiple domains? So these are real case projects that we're having. And so you can see that there's the domain module, and there you can set up loads of different domains. And basically the cool thing is we have the one database, and then we can share users, content, but we can also have the content available on just the one domain, things like that. I've put a few links to the API first initially, so because I thought, what about that decoupled approach? This is a very good talk about 12 projects that are fed by one backend, Drupal, and it's fully decoupled. So if you're into that, definitely go about those links. Commerce, we've talked about it, is a huge, it's a great distribution. I mean, Ryan was talking about it this morning. I don't think I need to talk too much. It's really cool. And then, yeah, I mean, wrapping up, given you a fair amount of modules in there. But some of you might be saying, but you're missing, yeah, probably I'm missing a lot of really cool modules that you will know, so I'm happy to listen for you. Again, I just try my best to give you a good overview of many modules that you could use. Instead of this, you could have used that as well. I totally agree. I mean, Drupal, the good thing about having so many is that we can choose. And then, yeah, I mean, as I said at the beginning, there is a module for almost everything. This image was, I found it on Drupal. Basically, they encourage you to always try something that is out there. If it doesn't fit what you need, try to help them so that it accomplishes what you need. And eventually, if you don't find anything, then write custom code. So, yeah, I mean, that was it. As I said, the slides, all of them are going to be available on that. They are already online and public, so you can just go through them if you want. There is no time for Q&A, but I'm going to be here today, tomorrow, so feel free to reach out to me and ask me anything. So, thank you all.
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
I loved your presentation. It was really helpful. A couple of sites I've got clients that just uploaded tons of really large images.
Uh-huh.
Is there anything you'd recommend? I think I can't, you know, I can't move them. Is there anything you recommend I can use to kind of just scale, you know,
yeah,
resize them?
So, image. So, there are a couple of modules that you can do, which is. Some of them are paid version, some of them like this, they are free,
yeah,
which is pretty good, this really is massive. One of the features that they give you is that when they upload something, it will just compress it for you and optimize it. So,
will it work with existing images that are already uploaded?
That's a very good question. For that, I recommend, this is not a module, this is built into Drupal. In its format, no. I don't know how it's called right now. So on Drupal you can set up image types,
yeah,
and in there you can set up a size, and that usually when you are outputting in the managed display,
yeah,
you can tell it to use that version, and that will take, for example, say a 2 megabytes image, and we crop it to the size you want, and I will definitely, so the original image will still be in your server,
yeah,
but the image that you will serve the user will be optimized,
yeah,
for that. It's, I think it's image styles.
Yeah, that one I know. Yeah, I know that one.